Good morning. So let's start our sixth session on module 5, that is low pass and high pass filters we have to analyze. In the previous class, we have spoken about what are active filters and what are the other classifications of filters, and also how to identify the different parameters related to filters. So we spoke about the pass band, stop band. We spoke about the frequency responses of the various type of filters. We spoke about cutoff or critical frequencies. We also spoke about the roll off rate. All these are various parameters associated with filters. So we defined all these things and we had an introduction class to the filters, their classifications and the various parameters. Okay, so in today's class, let's try to continue with where we had left off. So what do you expect in the outcomes of session 6? At this, at the end of the session, you can see that you'll be able to understand the working and design of the circuits of both low pass and high pass filters. Okay. And other than that, we will be able to derive the expressions for the transfer functions of both first order and second order low pass as well as high pass filters. So I've also explained to you what do you mean by order of a filter. Okay, so it is the power of the Laplacian variable S in the denominator, or it is also a measure of the number of poles present in a given filter transfer function. A one pole filter will have will be of first order usually. Two poles, second order, likewise. So all this we discussed. Next, let's move on to a low pass filter. So low pass filter, we know, is a circuit with the frequency representation characteristics as shown here. In the sense, the gain of this low pass filter, it would be one, or it would pass on the signals on the input side at low frequencies and it will attenuate the signals at high frequencies. You can see it is passing the signals at low frequencies and attenuating at high frequencies. So this is the ideal response. As you can see, a practical response will be something like this. It has what? It would have 0 dB gain if we don't give any actual gain. If I don't use an active filter and if I don't incorporate any gain in the circuit, then the maximum output would be same as the input. Okay. So 0 dB would be the value of, so here what do I plot? This is a plot of 20 log V naught by Vi, right? The gain in decibels. So on the Y axis, I have gain in decibels. On the X axis, we have the frequency. Frequency is marked at a spacing of one decade each. So 0.01 FC, 0.1 FC, FC, like that. So frequency is marked at a spacing of one decade, which is multiplication by a factor of 10. And maximum value of gain is 0 dB, as you can see. And when I come down by 3 decibels, I'll mark the cutoff frequency or the critical frequency of the filter, which is denoted as FC. And then there is a transition happening after this cutoff or critical frequency. You can see there is a sudden fall in the gain. There is a quick fall in the gain, and that is called your transition region. And this is also known as roll off of the gain. The gain rolls off at a rate of minus 20 decibels per decade if it is a first order filter. Okay, so this is the what? Practical response of a low pass filter. And what is the bandwidth of a low pass filter? The bandwidth of a low pass filter will always be the cutoff frequency, higher cutoff frequency FC or FH minus the lower cutoff frequency. The signal starts passing at zero frequency. So FC or FH minus zero, which will be FC itself. So in a low pass filter, the bandwidth of the filter is directly equal to its what? Cutoff frequency. Please remember that. So with this basic definition of a low pass filter, let's move on to the derivation of the transfer function of a low pass filter. So this is the circuit of the low pass filter as shown. You can see this is the circuit of the low pass filter. Here it's a first order low pass filter which we are trying to discuss. So there is a single resistor R in series with the non-inverting input and a capacitor here in parallel. So this resistor is shown as a potentiometer, a variable resistor, but you can have a constant resistor also if you have designed. You have designed and you have the exact R value available. It can be a simple constant resistor and a capacitor. So one single RC circuit connected at the non-inverting terminal, and the input is given at the input of the RC circuit. This represents a first order low pass filter. And coming to one more term which may not be clear to you here, that is Butterworth. Here, other than let's say other than the classifications which we discussed, we have three more classifications for filters. One is based on their frequency response. This is one is the Butterworth filter. Next one is the Chebyshev filter. And the third one is the Kaur filter. So what is the difference between these? Here in a Butterworth filter, you see the pass band and stop band, both are completely flat. So it is called a flat filter. I hope you are able to understand here. You see the frequency response is completely flattened in the pass band, and it is also a flattened response in the stop band. Hence the other name for this Butterworth filter is a flat filter. Coming to the Chebyshev filter, this Chebyshev filter has a frequency response, say something like this. It peaks and it settles. So what are you seeing? You are seeing a ripple in pass band. So at the end of pass band, there is a ripple. There is also a ripple in stop band also. So you have ripples in both pass band and stop band. Hence, we have ripples in both pass band and stop band in a Chebyshev filter. It's not a flat response as shown in Butterworth, but it's going to have ripples in pass band and stop band. Coming to this Kaur filter, the third type, this Kaur filter will have a ripple only in the pass band and it will have a flat stop band. So the stop band is flat, whereas there is a ripple in pass band. Okay, ripple in pass band. This is known as a Kaur filter. So generally, for most of our applications, we'll not need these ripples. But there are a few applications where those ripples would turn out to be useful. Say I have some signals where I need to give higher gain to the signals at the end of the passband. So something like that. Certain frequencies should get a different treatment. Then I'll make use of this Chebyshev or Kaur filter. But the most commonly used of all the filters is the Butterworth filter. Please remember this. So Butterworth filter is something which has a flat passband as well as a flat stop band. Okay. So other than that, in our studies, we'll be studying only about Butterworth filters. We'll not study Chebyshev or Kaur filter in this module. But later on, once you will be studying digital signal processing and all, there you'll be studying about Chebyshev filters also. Okay. So let's move on to this single pole or single RC time constant low pass filter. It's also a Butterworth filter because it will generate a completely flattened response. Okay. So the input signal is given to the RC network. R is in series, C is in parallel. And this junction of R and C is connected as input to the non-inverting terminal. And you see at the inverting terminal, we have also included two resistors, one in the feedback RF, one in the input side between inverting terminal and ground, that is R1. So what do you think this op-amp circuit is working as? The op-amp circuit is working as, so this circuit is working as what? Yes, it is a non-inverting amplifier. Here, the op-amp is connected as a non-inverting amplifier. And to that non-inverting amplifier on the input side, we have connected one RC network to which we have given the input signal. Okay. So the final value of voltage V1 at this point, let's try to derive the expression. So for now, we'll be considering this RC network, and given the input Vin, we will try to find what is the output V1. So that V1 would be the voltage. V1 would be the voltage here. Remember, this point we are calling as V1. Okay. So let's try to do that. The gain of a non-inverting amplifier, all of us are familiar, we have derived before. It is defined as 1 plus RF by R1, where RF is the resistance in the feedback and R1 is the resistance connected to the inverting input terminal. So AF represents the gain with feedback. We know that a non-inverting amplifier has this gain, and we are also familiar with the fact that the reactance offered by a capacitance XC is given as 1 over 2 pi FC. Okay. So all of us know these basic relations. With that, let's try to consider this RC network and let me try to find the value of V1 given Vin. Can you tell me what would be the value of V1 for this RC network? Input voltage is Vin. So it's a simple voltage divider. Yes or no? A simple voltage divider, Vin into XC divided by R plus XC. Or if I want to consider J also, I know I should take, since J will come in the 1 by J omega C, I'll get in the denominator. When I take it to the numerator, it becomes minus J. See, XC is also defined as, 1 by J omega C. And if you take this J to the numerator, it becomes minus J divided by omega C or minus J into XC, where XC is 1 by omega C or 1 by 2 pi FC. Both these mean one and the same, right? This is how we have written. Now, The same thing I am writing. V1 is the voltage drop across this capacitor. So it will be the value of the capacitive reactance minus jXc into Vin, the total voltage, divided by R minus jXc or R plus XC by J, whatever you want, you can call. So we have already derived this, if you remember, when we did it in module 2. Anyway, let's redo it here. So V1 is nothing but the voltage across this capacitance. So the capacitive reactance can be considered as minus jXc. So minus jXc into Vin divided by R plus minus jXc or R minus jXc. This would give you the value of Vin, V1. Now I'll simplify that. We'll divide both numerator and denominator with minus jXc. What would you get? You would have simply 1 into Vin in the numerator, and this minus jXc divided by minus jXc, the second term becomes 1, and the first term, R divided by minus jXc, that minus j, when it comes to the numerator here, it becomes plus j into R into XC. And what would XC be? Divided by XC. And XC is 1 by 2 pi FC. So if you substitute this value, you will get 1 plus j 2 pi FRC here. So substitute the value of XC. When I told you, what have we done here? We have divided. We have divided both numerator and denominator by minus jXc. Okay. So what will I get here? This becomes Vin into 1, and this will be R by minus jXc plus 1. So that plus 1, we are writing it here. And this R divided by minus jXc, minus j going here will become plus j into R. And 1 by XC is 2 pi FC that I have substituted. We know 1 by XC is 2 pi FC. So once you substitute that, you'll get this. And what will be the final output, V out or V naught? The final output V out or V naught is nothing but what? It is 1 plus RF by R1, the gain of this network, into the input voltage V1. So I already have the expression for input voltage V1 that multiplied with the gain of the non-inverting amplifier here will give you the final output voltage V out or V naught. We are interested in finding the transfer function V out by V in. It will be, I'll take this 1 plus RF by R1 as AF. So V in has come to the left hand side. So I'll get AF divided by 1 plus J 2 pi F RC. So this will become the expression for the transfer function of the first order low pass filter. Please ask if you have any doubts. If I'm interested in finding the magnitude of this transfer function, because that will help me in plotting the frequency response, what would the magnitude be? It would be AF divided by root of 1 plus 2 pi F into RC the whole square. Remember, how do I find the magnitude of any function in the form A plus J into B? Root of a square plus b square. That's what we have done. This is in the form a plus j into b, right? So it's a complex number. The magnitude of a complex number will be root of square of the real term plus square of the imaginary term coefficient. So we'll get this. Therefore, I can simplify this telling when the frequency of operation equals the cutoff frequency of the circuit. So when F is equal to FC or FH, we call it as. We also call the cutoff frequency of a low pass filter as the higher cutoff frequency, because it happens in the higher end, right? So it is also named as FH. Whenever this cutoff or critical frequency FH is equal to F, or when the actual frequency becomes equal to the cutoff frequency, what would happen at that point? So if you, what do you call as cutoff frequency? So first I should define the term cutoff frequency. As you can see here, this cutoff frequency is defined by FH. So in this, let FH or FC, let it be 1 by 2 pi RC. We'll call this as the cutoff frequency. So in this equation, if I replace 2 pi RC with FH or 1 by FH, what will I get? This I'll get it as AF divided by root of 1 plus F by FH square. So this is F by FH square, right? Where FH is 1 by 2 pi RC. Now, if I substitute F as equal to FH, or whenever the frequency of operation equals to the cutoff frequency FH, what will happen to this value? This value will become AF divided by root of 1 plus 1 square or root 2. That's what we are telling here. Therefore, whenever the actual frequency of operation equals to the cutoff frequency, at that point, the gain becomes maximum gain with feedback, that is AF 1 plus RF by R1 divided by root 2. Okay. And this frequency, the cutoff frequency, is defined as 1 by 2 pi RC. So please remember that. That's how you define the cutoff frequency, or the expression for cutoff frequency is given like this. And okay. So with this understanding, let me continue. To draw the frequency response characteristics, as you can see, the frequency response characteristics is a plot of gain in decibels. Remember, this axis is the gain in decibels we are plotting. So here, this is the gain in decibels. We are plotting 20 log of V naught by V in, and this is frequency. You can see the x-axis is frequency in hertz. And as I have told you before, we need to use a logarithmic scale for the frequency and a normal scale for the y-axis, the gain. Y log scale, so that you can accommodate a huge variation of frequency on a single graph sheet. So whenever I want to vary the frequency from 0 hertz to 1 megahertz or 10 megahertz, whatever range you want, the possibility is only when you make use of a logarithmic scale. That's why the graph sheet on which you plot a frequency response is also known as the semi-log sheet. Okay. It's a semi-log graph sheet where the x-axis will be logarithmic and the y-axis will be normal. Okay. So now, why will this characteristic come like this? Let's try to analyze what happens. As I have already written, V out by V in the previous case, we saw it will result as AF divided by 1 plus J F by FH, where FH is the cutoff frequency 1 by 2 pi RC. Now, let us justify why the characteristics will look like this. What happens when F is very small when compared to FH? Whenever this frequency F is very small when compared to FH, what will happen to this denominator? The denominator will be very small, or the output will be equal to almost AF. So you can see at low frequencies, okay, at the low frequency range, the output V out by V in, or the gain, will almost be equal to the overall gain AF of the non-inverting amplifier, because the denominator will be a very, very small value at low frequencies. That's why you'll get almost a straight line at 0 dB. Here, Vout will become equal to Vin if I don't give any gain. But if I have a gain, then Vout will be slightly more. It need not be at zero. It can be, I'll show you in an example, it can be 4 decibels or something like that, depending on the value of gain. Anyway, so you will get the highest gain, and it will remain almost constant at low frequencies whenever F is very small when compared to FH. Here F is very small when compared to FH. Hence, you get the pass band where maximum gain is there at output. V naught is greater than or equal to Vin, depending on whether we have given some gain in the circuit. Next, at F is equal to FH, what happens? So, this is the frequency when F is equal to FH. So, at the frequency F is equal to FH, you will get the gain value becoming AF divided by what? Root 2. We saw, because the magnitude of the gain will be AF divided by root of 1 plus 1, which will become root 2. So if you have the value as AF by root 2, how much is 20 log of 1 by root 2? If you try to find 20 log of 1 by root 2, that value turns out to be minus 3 decibels. So as you can see here, this 20 log of 1 by root 2 is minus 3 decibels, which we have marked. So the corresponding point here is the cutoff frequency FH or FC, beyond which what happens? As the frequency increases in this range, so as the frequency tends to increase beyond this value, you see, as the frequency increases after FC or FH, the gain decreases rapidly because this denominator would be large. Remember, the magnitude in the denominator is root 1 plus F by FH, the whole square. So it is square of F by FH. The larger the value of F, the larger will be F by FH square. Okay. So the denominator increases and this gain will start decreasing rapidly. That's how you notice this transition region. So I hope you understood how we get this kind of frequency response. And we also know the bandwidth of the filter should be this cutoff frequency FC or FH minus zero, because it starts passing signals at zero frequency. So FH minus zero would give you the bandwidth of this filter. Magnitude of this is, as usual, I told you, it is a complex function in the form a plus jb. So root of a square plus b square we get. And how do I find the phase angle of this signal? Naturally, tan inverse b by a. So in this case, it will be tan inverse f by fh divided by 1, or the phase angle is tan inverse f by fh. So please remember, whenever you make use of an RC circuit, you will surely have a phase difference. So whatever is the phase of the signal at the input, at the output, you will surely not have the same phase. Whenever there is an RC circuit, there is always a phase difference. And that value is given like this. So depending on the value of frequency, the operating frequency, the phase difference will also change. You see, this variable F is part of this phase equation. So as F increases, the phase difference will also change. Please keep it in mind. It's a function of the frequency. And the passband gain is AF, as we have already discussed. And as I told you, how do I find this cutoff frequency point? It is 1 by root 2 times AF. And 20 log of 1 by root 2 turns out to be minus 3 decibels, as I have already mentioned. So let's solve one numerical on the first order low pass Butterworth filter. Note down this question. Design a first order low pass filter to have a cutoff frequency of 1 kilohertz with a pass band gain of 2. So you're supposed to design for AF of 2. The gain in the passband should be 2 and the cutoff frequency FC should be 1 kilohertz. So normally it is best practice to assume capacitors to be less than 1 microfarad. We want to use ceramic capacitors which don't have any polarities. Remember, both the leads in a ceramic capacitor are equal in length. So there is nothing like positive or negative differentiation because the capacitance values are small. So it's always better to choose capacitors less than 1 microfarad for good results. Okay. And once we always start off our design by choosing capacitors, and then we will substitute the value of capacitors in the equation for the cutoff frequency. That is, FH is 1 by 2 pi RC. There you will substitute the value of C, and you already know FH is 1 kilohertz. So you can find R. Once you find R, the next thing is to find RF and R1. For that, I should use the gain condition of the non-inverting amplifier, 1 plus RF by R1, and it should be equal to 2. So in other words, RF by R1 will be 1. Or RF is equal to R1. Whatever value you choose for R1, the same thing can be chosen for what? RF also. I hope I can write properly here. Say, let C be 0.01 microfarad. Okay, if you choose C as 0.01 microfarad, can you find R now? Therefore, R will be 1 by 2 pi, that is 0.01 into 10 power minus 6, the C I am putting in the denominator, into F. F is 1 kilohertz, so it is 10 power 3. So if you substitute and if you try to find the value of R here, that will represent the RC values in the filter. And the next thing what I should do is, we know that gain AF is given as 1 plus RF by R1, which is specified as 2. Therefore, RF by R1 will be 2 minus 1 or 1. Therefore, RF is equal to R1. Let R1 be 10 kilo ohm. Therefore, RF will also be 10 kilo ohm. As simple as that. So I need not worry too much about the design of this circuit. It's a very simple design which we have considered. All you have to do is just substitute in the standard equation. Okay. I hope it is clear. Can you see this clearly? Any doubts with this? So this is the simplest design. You can also draw the circuit if it carries more marks. So generally for 4 marks or something, it's enough if you just design for the values of RC, RF and R1. And when you're choosing RF and R1, remember, don't choose RF and R1 to be very small, not in ohms. It's better if it is in kilo ohms for getting proper impedance in the op-amp circuit. To avoid any loading effect, it's better if the values of the resistors are in kilo ohms. Okay. So with that, we can move on to the second order filter. So what are the basics of a second order filter? The second order filter transfer function will normally be in this form. As you can see, it will have the S square term in the denominator and it will have a factor 2 zeta, which you can see. Okay. That is, this zeta is known as the damping coefficient. This zeta is the damping coefficient, and 1 by 2 times zeta gives you the quality factor Q of the filter. Okay. So the damping coefficient is something which you have learnt in control systems. And for a second order system, it is compulsory that the transfer function of this system will be in this form. And there is one more condition in a second order system. This 2 zeta, or the damping factor here, will have a fixed value. So we have 2 zeta into 2 pi fc into f s, and plus 2, or we'll call this as omega c the whole square. So it is omega c square divided by s square plus 2 zeta omega c plus omega c whole square. That's how I can write this transfer function. And you see one more thing here. What happens to the passband ripple as zeta value changes? So what type of filter are we considering? Which type of filter are we considering? Remember, we are interested in Butterworth filters. To get the Butterworth response, what is the Butterworth response? It should have a flat pass band and a flat stop band. Both stop band and pass bands are very flat. It's also called a flat filter. So in this, you can observe where do I, for which value of zeta do I have a flat? Can you see, observe here the red one? For zeta is equal to 0.7071, I have the flattest response without any ripple. Okay. So this is the basic reason. You will be asked in Viva in the lab, what is the reason for this damping factor to be 0.707? For Butterworth response, to get a flat response without any ripple, I need to have this damping factor as 0.707. You can see for other damping factors how the ripple is generated. Okay. So please remember, this is important. The value of zeta for a Butterworth filter should be 0.707. Okay. And to find the value of Q, which will be 1 by 2 zeta, so its value will be how much? 1 by 2, 2 into 0.707, or 1 by 1.1414. That would be the value of the Q factor. Now let's see the circuit connection and the derivation for second order low pass Butterworth filter. You will be doing this, or you have already done it in the lab also. So in a second order low pass filter, I'll have two RC sections. So as you can see, we have two RC sections in a second order low pass filter, with R as the series element and C as the parallel. And to get a proper low pass transfer function, I told you the transfer function of a second order system should be in this form. This is the standard form, the standard transfer function for any second order system. To get it in this form, we need to connect one capacitor back to the output. In a feedback path, we have connected this C2 back to the output side in the feedback path, so that we will get the required transfer function in the standard form correctly. We'll be deriving that transfer function. As usual, we know S is equal to J omega, and XC, which is the capacitive reactance, is given as 1 by S into C. And as usual, this is still a non-inverting amplifier with feedback resistance R1 and the input resistance feedback resistance RF and input resistance R1. So the gain of this circuit is AF, which is 1 plus RF by R1. XC is 1 by J omega C, or 1 by 2 pi FC. here that j value we haven't shown, so we will take j out of xc. In this case, if I just replace 1 by sc, it will become 1 by j omega c directly. But if I want to keep j separate from xc, which we will show in the derivation, so just consider xc as 1 by omega c or 1 by 2 pi f into c. So what you have to remember in second order filter, two RC sections and the input. Now, let's consider these two RC sections and let us try to derive the expression for the transfer function V naught by V in. So this involves little more of your network basics. The V in is given to the beginning of the first RC section, R2 C2. And let me consider the voltage drop here as VA, and VA is given to the second RC section R3 C3. So we are calling the two resistors as R2 and R3 and capacitors as C2 and C3. And we know the voltage at this end here across R3 C3. The voltage across C3, we are calling it as V1. Okay. The voltage at C2, we are calling it as VA, this as V1, as you can see. So let us write the KCL equations at node VA. So if you apply KCL at node VA, you know the current I1 is entering the node, and I1 value is V in minus VA divided by R2. Can you see? So the value of the current I1, which is entering the node, is V in minus VA divided by R2. And the other two currents, I2 and I3, are leaving the node. So the value of I2 will be what? How do you find the current through the capacitance? How do you find the equation? It will be what? C2 into VA minus V naught. So the value of current through a capacitance is voltage into the value of capacitance. So we know that if I have C2 as the capacitance, the total current I2 will be equal to SC2 into the voltage drop across this capacitor, which will be VA minus V naught. Why is this end voltage at V naught? You see, where is capacitance C2 connected? One end of capacitance C2 is connected to the output voltage V naught. Therefore, if I write only the resistor capacitor loops as shown, this end is at voltage V naught, as you can see. Okay. That's why we have the voltage drop across this capacitance to be VA minus V naught. And what about I3? I3, again, the voltage drop across R3 is VA minus V1. The voltage at this point is V1. So VA minus V1 divided by R3 gives me the value of current I3. So we have just applied the KCL equation at this node. And all what we have to do is we have to simplify. So we know that VA minus V1 by R3, this one, when I move this to the other side, it will reduce. Or here, what is, where do I have this VA minus V1? It is the current through this. Can I also write it as the same current which flows through this capacitance C3? Yes, it's almost the same current. I3 is now flowing as I4 through this capacitance C3. And what is the voltage drop across this capacitance C3? It is V1 minus what? Zero. So if you want to write this current in terms of current I4, I can write it as C3 into S into V1 minus 0. The value of current I4 will be C3 into S into V1. So I have I4 as C3 S V1. and that I4 should be equal to I3, which was VA minus V1 by R3. So I'm just showing in this circuit, all what I'm doing is, okay, here we are just showing I3 is equal to I4. I4 is the drop in this capacitance C3 and I3 is the drop through the resistance R3. Okay. Next. We'll go on simplifying this. So what would be the expression for VA from this equation? You simplify this, VA turns out to be C3S V1 into R3. We are cross multiplying plus 1 into V1. We have taken this V1 to the other side. So you'll get an expression for VA. Now you substitute this VA in the first equation. I have VA in three places. You try to simplify this equation. So all what we are doing is simplification. I'll pass on this to you, both the PPT and in the notes, you will see the complete simplification. So stepwise, we are going to simplify this equation and we are finding an expression for V in. You can just see, I'm just substituting. Everything is simple substitution. Okay. And we'll end up in this equation. Finally, I am interested, as you can see here, what are we getting? I am getting V1 on the right hand side multiplied with a large values of products of R and C, right? And V in on the left hand side. We are interested in finding the ratio V1 by V in. So I want the ratio V1 by V in. What will happen? This would be the ratio. So if I want V1 by V in, then I'll have the whole equation shifted and this would turn out to be the final equation. You can see you have the S square term in the denominator plus some constant times S plus 1 by R2 C2 R3 C3 as the last term. So this last term can be taken as the square of the cutoff frequencies. Anyway, this V0 by Vin, if I'm interested. Remember, this stage is then passed on to here. This is passed on to a non-inverting amplifier where what do I have? I have one resistor R1 here and you have another resistor. You have another resistor here, RF. So V1 is fed to this. The output V0 will be V1 into 1 plus RF by R1, which we have seen already in the previous case also. So I'm multiplying. This is also known as AF. We also call this as AF. So what I have done, I have found V0 by Vin as AF into this ratio. V1 by Vin, we already have written something. Okay. Now, it's a large equation as you can see. Let me call omega n as 1 by root of R2 C2 R3 C3. See here, we have this 1 by R2 C2 R3 C3 in both numerator and denominator. So I want to name it as the angular frequency omega n, and it is 1 by root of this. So what will happen to 1 by R2 C2 R3 C3? It will be omega n square. So this term here, this term will reduce to omega n square, and this term will also be omega n square according to this consideration. Therefore, the transfer function which we have derived here is in the form AF, which can also be considered as a constant K times omega n square, divided by s square plus 2 zeta omega n into s plus omega n square. So what is the value of this 2 zeta? We have to check out. Okay. So k is the DC gain, which is 1 plus RF by R1. Zeta is the damping factor. Wn is the undamped natural frequency. So using this, we can define the final cutoff frequency of the second order low pass filter to be 1 by 2 pi into root R2 C2 R3 C3. So if omega n is so much, omega n is equal to 2 pi into fh. Yes or no? So this value is 2 pi fh. And if you are interested in finding just fh, it will be what? 1 by 2 pi into whatever we have before. Okay. Therefore, if I'm trying to define the magnitude of V0 by Vn to draw the frequency response curve, this will turn out to be AF divided by root of 1 plus F by FH the whole to the power of 4. If you remember, for the first order low pass filter, we have F by FH the whole square. Here, I already have a square term, so it will be F by FH the whole to the power of 4. Now, can you check what will happen at various frequencies? For F much, much less than FH, you have the maximum output or the maximum gain, AF. So the output would be equal to the maximum gain, AF. Then at the frequency F is equal to FH, what will happen to the value of V0 by Vn? This value will be AF by root 2 actually. And in terms of decibels, it will be minus 3 dB. So you see, this is a point where minus 3 dB, we get the cutoff frequency FH. Okay. And after the cutoff frequency, as F increases, beyond FH. So beyond the cutoff frequency, as F increases, you see in this equation, it is F by FH to the power of 4, which means the deterioration rate of the gain is much faster. So here you can see the slope of this roll off will be minus 40 decibels per decade rather than minus 20 decibels, which we got in first order low pass filter. Okay. So please understand, in a second order low pass filter, because of getting a transfer function which should resemble a standard second order system, I will always get what? The roll off rate, the rate at which the gain is falling in the transition region, to be minus 40 decibels per decade rather than minus 20 decibels per decade, which happened in the first order low pass filter. Okay. So this is about the second order low pass filter, the design consideration for this. So we know the standard equation of the second order low pass filter. If I consider R2 is equal to R3 and C2 is equal to C3, that's the normal way how we do it in the lab. Rather than considering two different resistors, two different capacitors, so it would be a lot of complication, right? So we just have to equate both the resistors to both the capacitors. Then in the numerator, it becomes 1 by RC square. And in the denominator, I'll get S square plus, you see, this whole thing will reduce to 3 minus AF into S divided by RC. So remember, RC is nothing but omega plus 1 by RC square, you get again. Now, remember the standard transfer function. What did I have with omega NS in the second term? 2 zeta. That 2 zeta, the damping factor in this case, this 1 by RC is nothing but omega n. So omega n into S multiplied with 2 zeta. 2 zeta value should be equal to 3 minus AF. Remember that. And For the Butterworth approximation, we already saw what should be the value of zeta. Zeta should be 0.707 to get a flat response in the passband without any ripple. We showed that. So the damping factor should be 0.707 to get the flat Butterworth response. Therefore, if I substitute this zeta value here, 2 into 0.707 is 3 minus AF. So what should be the value of AF? It turns out that the gain for a second order filter will always be 1.586 or 1.6. So you will be asked the question, why should the gain of a second order system always be 1.586? The reason for that is to get the correct Butterworth approximation in the frequency response of the passband without having any ripple, the damping factor should be 0.707. And from the transfer function of our second order filter, we got 3 minus AF as equivalent to twice the damping factor. So when I substituted the value of the damping factor required, I will get AF, the gain with feedback, to be 1.586, which is compulsory for a second order filter. So I can't design a second order filter for a gain of 2 or 3 or 4. I should always consider the gain of a second order filter to be 1.586 to get the correct flat Butterworth response. Please remember that. Okay. The same thing is shown here. Let's consider one numerical on the second order Butterworth low pass filter. Make a note, design a second order low pass filter to have a cutoff frequency of 1 kilohertz, a passband gain of 1.586. Even whether they mention it or not, we should always consider the passband gain to be 1.586 in second order system. So what should I do? I have to assume the capacitors to be equal, C2 equal to C3, and try to assume for a value less than 1 microfarad. Here we have assumed 0.0047 microfarad. So if I assume the capacitors C2 and C3 to be 0.0047 microfarad, then we have also assumed R2 to be equal to R3. What was the expression for the cutoff frequency in a second order filter? FH is 1 by 2 pi root R2 R3 into C2 C3. That R2 equal to R3 will become just R out of the square root sign. So the expression for FH will simply become 1 by 2 pi RC if I substitute R2 as R3 and C2 as C3, right? So this is the same expression which we had in a first order filter. You need to find R from this. You know FH is 1 kilohertz. You know C is 0.0047 microfarad. So try to find the value of R. And whatever R you get, R2 should be equal to R3. It should be normally less than 100K. And again, coming to the design of RF and R1 for the non-inverting amplifier, I know the gain AF should be 1.586, which is nothing but 1 plus RF by R1. So 1 plus RF by R1 should be 1.586. So what should be the value of RF by R1? It will be 0.586. Assume R1 to be less than 100K, so that RF would be 0.58 times R1. As simple as that. So we have just shown how to consider the value of FH and this. The ratio I already mentioned, RF by R1 should be 0.586, because 1 plus RF by R1 is 1.586. The solution for that is as shown in this. You can make a note. We have assumed C2, C3 as 0.0047, as I told you. You find R, where R2 is equal to R3, you'll get around 33.86K. We'll choose 33K as the standard value for R2 and R3. And next, to find RF, RF shouldn't be too large. So R1 then should also be assumed sufficiently. Let's assume R1 to be less than 100K normally. Let's take R1 as 27 kilo ohm. So what would RF be? It will be 0.586 into 27K or 15.82 kilo ohms. Okay. So RF can be taken as a 20 kilo ohm potentiometer so that you will be able to adjust the resistance to get the exact value of gain. If the gain has to be 1.586 or it is showing 1.6 or something, you can slowly adjust the potentiometer value. So use 20K pot instead of 15.8K resistor. We don't have the exact standard value. We have 15K or we have 18K next. All the standard values of resistors you should be knowing by now. R2, R3, 33K, C2, C3, 0.0047. And R1 is 27K and RF is how much? 15.8K, for which we use a 20K pot. Okay. Coming to the last part, just take few minutes. How to plot the frequency response? Even that is asked in the problem. To plot the frequency response of a second order filter, I should consider the magnitude of the transfer function. What will happen to magnitude of V0 by Vin? It was given as AF divided by root of 1 plus F by FH the whole to the power of 4. In this, AF is substituted as 1.586 and FH is given as 1 kilohertz. We will start off by assuming F as 10 hertz, 100 hertz, 200, then 700, 1K. So you will go on assuming different values of this variable frequency F. So this variable frequency F can take different values in this equation. Those values are listed in the left hand side of the table. Choose the value so that there will be a clear separation and I can plot the graph sheet smoothly. The frequency response curve. So at 10 hertz, what is the gain? At 100 hertz, what is the gain? You see, it remains constant. If you substitute these values, you are going to get the value as approximately 1.58 or 1.59. Okay. And next, you have to find 20 log V0 by VI, which will give you the gain in decibels. So can you observe at low frequencies, the gain is 4 decibels here instead of 0 dB, which we had in our previous plot. And that is because the second order filter should have a gain of 1.586. You'll see if you go on substituting here for each of the frequencies, you will see you'll get almost a flat response until you reach the cutoff frequency of 1K. At 1K, you should measure, you'll be getting 4 minus 3 dB or it should be 1 dB. At 1 kilohertz frequency, the cutoff frequency, the output voltage will be 1 dB because it should be maximum minus 3, 4 minus 3. After that, again, the rate decreases quickly like this. Okay. So I think we'll not proceed with the high pass. We'll continue with high pass in the next class. So let me just summarize what we did for today. In this session, we spoke about low pass filter. Basically, we could understand the working of the circuit and also we designed the circuit. We derived the expression for the transfer function of both first order and second order low pass filter. Let's do that for high pass filter. You can even try out at home. It's a similar procedure for a high pass filter. In high pass, we will interchange the position of R and C. You had R as the horizontal or series element, C as the parallel. You just put C here and R here. It becomes a high pass filter. So let's study that in the next class.